My name is Jim Matteoni. I'm an instructor at Kwantlen at the Langley campus, and I teach pest management and botany. So what I'm going to be talking about today, first of all, is why I'm so interested in bees. One out of every three bites of food that goes in your mouth is subject to pollination of some sort. Without the bees, we're going to starve. So I love bees. They're very important, and I think the more we tell people about bees, the better off we're going to be.
Hi, my name is Stephanie Phillips. I'm a faculty member in design. I teach in fashion design, fashion marketing, product design, and design for technical apparel. Tonight I'll be speaking about how bees can be inspiring to the world of design and how we create our future. Tonight's talk I think is really interesting because we're bringing to everyone a multidisciplinary understanding of the very fascinating world of the bee. And in regards to design, how the bee can inspire us to build something that we haven't ever built before.
Tonight I'll talk about how we can use bees in psychology, and I will give three reasons for this, and I will show some pictures and I'll show some results of the kinds of experiments that we have done in the bee lab specifically. Bee brains offer a simple, affordable, and convenient solution to studying brains. Bees have very capable brains. They can learn, they can memorize, they have visual perceptions, and we can ask many of the same questions that we can ask with humans.
Welcome to Science World. I am Andrea Durham, Vice President of Exhibits, Digital and Evaluation here at Science World, and I would like to welcome you all here and thank you for coming to this event tonight. So, did everybody enjoy the activities out there? Did everybody get to make a beeswax candle? I am like ridiculously excited about my beeswax birthday candle. So I would like to thank the Science World and KPU teams for creating those activities and having the fun events out there. They really are at the heart of what Science World is all about, learning and hands-on activities and exploring. So thank you for coming to enjoy those activities as well as the talk tonight. We are planning to do more of those types of hands-on activities in the future. So I'm glad you enjoyed them, and I hope you can come back again. The partnership with KPU is a wonderful one. We have now been doing this for a bit and have a full year ahead of us of exciting talks. And it's all part of Science World and our role in the community. We really are here to serve the community as a charitable nonprofit organization. We couldn't be here without the community. Both your support by walking through the door, your support by talking about how things like this that are exciting to come to, and donors and corporations and really partnerships like this that allow us to extend our reach far beyond Vancouver and throughout BC. So thank you for that support, and thank you to KPU for having this wonderful partnership that we both enjoy so very much. With that, I would like to introduce Dr. Betty Warabek, the Dean of Science and Horticulture at KPU, who is in turn going to introduce our speakers this evening. Excuse me.
Kind of a long way around. I don't want to touch anything because there's beautiful pictures of bees on this laptop here, but on behalf of KPU, welcome here, and we hope you come to all of our talks. It's so exciting to be able to see the public and for you to see what we do at KPU. So each of you would have received a survey when you first came in, and I saw many of you feverishly filling that out, so please fill that in and put your name in the draw. We do use the survey information for our future talks, and you know, we sometimes use the information for planning purposes within the university, so your feedback is very, very much appreciated. So tonight is the second talk in the 16-17 KPU Science World Speaker Series. Topic is Inspiration of Bees. We all love bees. And tonight we have actually four speakers, and I'm going to introduce them all at the beginning And then I don't want to interfere with their mojo as they're talking, because I think they're doing some sort of feeding off of each other. So I'm just going to introduce each one of them briefly, and then I'll do a little bit more of a bio. So please bear with me, because I think it's important for you to know who these people are and how diverse their backgrounds are and how what they study has to do with bees. So our three KPU speakers are Jim Matteoni. So Jim, if you just stand up and wave, there you go. Okay. Stephanie Phillips. Levente Orban. There he is in the front. There he is. And at the end, we're also going to hear from Matthew Kimshaw. And where's Matthew? There he is there. We've got our fun young people all dressed up like bees. And Matthew and his group, they're the Environmental Youth Alliance. And he's going to talk about the Wild Mine Project. So he'll be at the end of the KPU speakers. So our first speaker will be Jim Matteoni. Jim was born in Chicago, and his interest in horticulture started with running a landscape maintenance group at the age of 12. He abandoned college studies in nuclear physics and changed to plant pathology, entomology, and ornamental horticulture. After obtaining his PhD at Cornell University, Jim started his career as a research scientist with Agriculture Canada at the Vineland Research Station. He moved out to BC, where he did his research on mating and breeding on the western bumblebee. Jim is a semi-retired faculty member with the School of Horticulture at KPU, and being semi-retired allows him to spend more time doing some of his lifelong interests, which include gardening, and he's volunteering with the Strathcona Community Gardens, so some of you may be part of that group and might know Jim from that. Next is Stephanie Phillips. Stephanie's an educator and a designer with a focus on materials and their life cycle. Stephanie's interdisciplinary views on the field of design is apparent as her current role at the Wilson School of Design encompasses teaching in multiple programs, including product design, design for technical apparel, fashion design, and fashion marketing. With a Bachelor of Applied Arts in Fashion from Ryerson, and a master's degree in textile futures from Central St. Martin's College of Art and Design in London, England, Stephanie's design practice focuses on the development of new materials that are in sync with the natural world. So interesting to hear how bees come into that. I guess it's the natural world. Finally, we have Levente Orban, became interested in psychology while studying at Kwantlen University College. That was before Kwantlen was a university, and now we're KPU. He completed his undergraduate honors thesis with Dr. Farhad Dastur. And some of you, if you had been to the talks earlier in the year, Farhad gave a wonderful talk, again, a psychology-themed one. Levente continued his education at the University of Ottawa to complete his PhD in psychology. Levente has recently returned to KPU as a faculty member in the psychology department. His teaching specialties include cognition, statistics, and research methods. His research mainly focuses on the area of visual information processing and answering the question, how do bees first find flowers? So, without any further ado, we will begin with Dr. Jim Matteoni, Stephanie Levente, and then Matthew. Okay, enjoy.
Thank you very much, and I'd like to say that it's a pleasure to be here, and I have to claim guilt with Stephanie, because I think about 3 years ago, we were asked to submit a bunch of titles to Science World that would be interdisciplinary. So we did that, and we kind of got Levente involved in this by default. So, but we came up with a whole bunch of ideas, and I think this is the first, which is truly three different departments at the school cooperating on one talk. So I'm really excited about this, and you can tell. Now, ask a couple of things of you. If you have questions or you have difficulty understanding me because I had a stroke, so sometimes I talk funny, get my attention. Please throw something at me. But no, wait a minute. It's got to be something soft and dry. Okay. Beeswax will work, that's fine. Okay. So, one of the things I want to do first is talk about what bees need to survive. You're looking at a picture of honeybees. These are the bees that you think of most often. But remember, the honeybees are not native. They're not originally from North America. They were brought over from Europe. So before honeybees were here, a whole host of native bees and bumblebees included did all the pollination. And the importance of pollination is really simple. One out of every three bites of food you take relied on pollination. One third of your food. So just think what happens if the pollinators are gone. So let's take a look. Everyone knows honeybees, but on the right-hand side, we've got bumblebees, and this is a bumblebee nest in the ground, which is normal. Honeybees might be in a tree, your house, or woodwork, but bumblebee nests, normally they're in an abandoned mouse nest in the ground. The life cycle is such that in the fall, starting about now, the queen bees go out from this nest, and there's the queen there. She's the big one in the center. And they will mate as many times as possible. Then they will store the sperm up in a special vessel and go back to the hive where they'll be force-fed by the rest of the bees. Then they're kicked out and never allowed back. They will then have to find a place to spend the winter, which is quite easy for them to do in BC because normally they take an abandoned mouse nest in the ground. That's what this is. So most bumblebee hives are in the ground. Honeybees compared to bumblebees have much, much larger colonies and produce much more honey. The bees go to flowers for two things, nectar and pollen. Nectar will provide them with a carbohydrate source for life, for energy. Pollen gives them protein. They must have both. Honeybees, these are smart. They stir enough nectar, enough honey in the hive to get them through inclement weather, cold periods. So they store enough so that if it's cold outside, these woozy bees don't have to go out of the hive. Bumblebees, on the other hand, gracious in their simplicity and small size, only store enough honey in the hive to get them through 24, 48 hours. So they must forage about every day, every other day. As a consequence, bumblebees forage down to 5 degrees centigrade. They forage in the rain. They can go outside because they navigate mostly by eyesight, whereas honeybees navigate using electromagnetic spectrum. They have a wonderful life cycle. All of the bees, almost all of the bees, have a very simple life cycle in order to determine sex. And if I'm ever up in front of a group and they don't talk about sex, it's the surest way to get the audience interested. Okay, that queen bee that went out in the fall and mated, she collects and stores the sperm and holds it until she needs it. Now think of this. Wouldn't this be nice if when you were in college, how No, think of it. If you could just store the sperm until you could afford to have babies, wouldn't that have been nicer? Not alone determining how many mates you want to have. But what she will do is she stores the sperm all winter, and as she lays the eggs, they're individually fertilized. Okay? Each one of those eggs then has two sets of chromosomes, and they will always develop into a female. Because there's a queen in the hive, those females will become workers. When the queen bee runs out of sperm, she continues to lay eggs, but they're not fertilized. Those eggs have one set of chromosomes, and they become males. The hive then approaches what we call crossover. These bees then sense there's males in the crowd. I'm not sticking around any longer, and it no longer becomes a viable pollinating unit. So the lifetime of bumblebees is no longer than 1 year. And their average hive size for some Western species, Bombus hantei and Rufus cinctus, is maybe 20 to 40 bees, that's it. What we do use in the hives you saw outside, they're the eastern bumblebee species, which can have a healthy hive of up to 200 or so workers. Okay? If I didn't get a chance to cram some science down your throat, I wouldn't enjoy it. So this is a honeybee. I want to point out some parts of the bee. First of all, this part down here is, yes, indeed, the stinger. But it also serves the function of being the ovipositor. So they lay eggs with the same functional instrument. Honeybees, when they sting, they usually lose their stinger and they'll die. Bumblebees, if they sting slowly enough, can sting multiple times. And the queen bee, if she stings, she cannot lose the stinger because she needs it to lay eggs. Okay, and a typical insect fashion, you have three body parts. That's the abdomen, which does most of the digestion. The breathing is done mostly in the abdomen because insects don't have a nose to breathe in and out of. They have a bunch of holes in the body. And so when you see a bee pulsing like this, it's breathing. It's forcing air in and out of its body. This middle part, the thorax, is where the wings are attached. And all bees are in the order called Hymenoptera. That means that the two wings on each side, and there's a large front wing here, and there's a second hind wing behind it, and then it goes behind like this. Those two wings are interconnected with a series of little hooks so that the wings don't flop around individually. They work like this, okay? And hymenos comes from the Greek meaning marriage. The two wings are married together. All bees are like that. Oh, now we get to the good part, the head. The head in the bees has got to do everything from feeding, but it's also part of the sensory structures. Okay, this part is going to be an antenna, which for most of the bees serves a function of kind of like tasting chemicals in the environment. If you figure bees have to go to flowers and identify the right flower, it's nice if this tasting structure can bend down to the mouth, okay? So the antennas go up like this and are hinged so that the tasting part is right here by the mouth. That's called geniculate, genu, from the joint there. There's a large compound eye here, and I'll have a front-on picture coming up next. And the honeybees and bumblebees, the mouth part is modified so that it functions like a tongue, so they can slurp up nectar. So we have to have a gross and disgusting picture at least once. So this is a head-on view of a honeybee. And here's a large compound eye. And each one of these facets makes a tiny picture of the environment. And then the brain kind of sort of puts it together, but is not as good as our eyesight by any means. But it gets a general, there's a pillar, there's stuff out here. Oh, there's a flower, okay? So that's one type of vine, but they've got another type. Right here, there are three black things called ocelli. These are simple eyes, and they only detect one of several different types of functions. They can detect light change, so sunlight, shade. They can detect movement. And notice those eyes are put on the top of the head so they can detect if a bird is going to come along and eat them. Okay, they can see that sort of movement. A spider's ocelli, a spider's simple eyes, are so good that they can detect movement from a twig, no, or movement from an insect they can eat. Then they jump. That's why you can't fool a spider by jiggling in a twig. They just think, oh, it's Jim again with a twig. Okay. Here in the front is the tongue. That's what they use to drink the nectar. Now, insects, they have an exoskeleton on the outside of the body. So every time they have to get bigger, they have to dissolve the skeleton from the guts, step out, and then get bigger, and then secrete a new skeleton. And as a consequence, all of their mouth parts are outside their body. Ours are inside their cheeks, okay? And insects' jaws don't go like this, they'll go like this, okay? And you can see the equivalent of mandibles or jaws down here. These jaws are like two petals, because when they collect pollen, they're going to mix it with some saliva till it gets in a little ball and stick it on the back leg to stow. And I'll show you a picture of that later. Here's a honeybee, and I think you can see the body here, the wings, so abdomen, thorax, and the head. And she's drinking. Here's her tongue going down to an acacia flower to drink nectar. The length of the bump, the honeybee tongue determines what type of flowers they can visit. There are short-tongued bees and long-tongued bees, and you have to know what the flower structure is before choosing the right one. Bees come in all sorts. There's about 20,000 species. So when you talk about bumblebees and honeybees, there's only two of them. This is a sweat bee, mostly metallic colored bees. And you can see in the head, the simple eyes, those spots right there. This one is a blue orchard mason bee. We use mason bees frequently, and this is what you normally used to see. These are the bees for which you build tunnels out of straw or wood so that you can have them for pollination. And you can actually purchase them as pupa, ready to emerge as an adult, and be as pollinators in the garden. All of these then will take the pollen and use it as food for the brood. These are leaf-cutting bees. They're a little more robust. They use those mandibles to cut a perfectly smooth edge on leaves. It's a good test question for students. Is this a disease or a bad insect? Lots of leaf-cutting bees. And here's the bumblebee. And this shows nicely how the antenna go down. Here's the tongue going down like that, drinking nectar. Another picture of the bumblebee, this case showing the pollen being stored on the back leg. And where would it be without a honeybee doing the same thing? And you can see again the antenna and the compound eyes. So I get to talk for just a moment about how important the bees are for pollination. This shows a tomato, okay? This, I could tell you, is a tomato that's been pollinated by bees. This is the placenta with the seeds. The seeds are attached by a little umbilical cord to the parent, just like people. If the bees do the pollinating, there are lots more seeds here. That means this area around the seeds is filled with a more slimy structure rather than a hollow, empty chamber. And secondly, the more seeds there are in a fruit, the thicker this wall is. I say you can tell a pollinated tomato from a non-pollinated, because a bee-pollinated tomato, if you throw it at a glass window, the window breaks. Plain old non-pollinated tomato, the tomato splats. And this is just a picture from the garden that I have, which brings me to my wrap-up here. The things we get from bees. Pollination is the most important thing. In BC alone, bumblebees and tomato greenhouses are worth, in 2014, almost $250 million, the industry and the pollination. The amount of increase in yield in the fruit is about 30%. Better fruit quality, bigger fruit, because it's more solid, it ships better. Honeybees are worth slightly more than that, about $260 million a year. We also get lots of food and wax and other things from the bees. And as I'm about to turn the floor over to Stephanie to talk about inspiration, where would it be without a picture from Beatrix Potter? And this is, I think, let's see, this is Mrs. Tittlemouse, and this is Babbity Bumblebee, which you all know now is anatomically incorrect. Only two body parts. Okay, so with that, I'll turn the floor over to Stephanie. If once again, Stephanie loves questions during her talk. So, okay.
Hi, everybody. I'm guessing you're all wondering, what do bees have to do with design? Can everyone hear me? I'm not sure. Yes? Yes, okay. Because I can talk louder, I'm sure about it. So what is it about bees that keeps us so incredibly fascinated? Throughout the ages, we've attached significant cultural meaning to bees, whether it is our contemporary use of the word hive to symbolize community, or that of ancient Egypt, where the meaning of bees was tied to royalty and power. The bee has permeated our culture beyond their amazing role as pollinators and makers of honey. Now, beyond the symbolic, how can bees be inspiring to designers? Before I can get too much further into this, I really wanted to create a little bit more context. Recently, there's been a shift in how designers have been working with nature as a source of inspiration, going beyond the aesthetic or symbolic and towards an understanding of nature's functions in order to use its genius. This practice has been called biomimicry and was brought to the fore by biologist Janine Benyus. Biomimicry creates partnerships between scientists, designers, and engineers as a method to use our skills and insights collaboratively in order to see the world in a new way and create a future that is more in sync with nature. Right, I have paper. While there are a plethora of examples from the inspiration of the lives of bees that fall within the field of biomimicry, the first thing, and I'm sure you're all thinking of this, that comes to mind is that of the hive itself. So this is an illumination from a book from about the 1700s. So this can look like anything. This is the internal structure of cardboard. If you ever get an IKEA table, if you ended up cutting that melamine off the top of the table, this is what it looks like inside. So that's a really simple kind of rough and tumble type of example, whereas this is a building that is currently being built in the Bahamas and was designed by the Bjark Engels Group and is a very beautiful contemporary piece of design. What's really interesting about this is that each one of the balconies uses the hexagonal shape to create a swimming pool. So the fact is that that dip in it creates a swimming pool on every single balcony. It should be completed in the next couple of years, and so we'll be able to see how well it works. But it's a really beautiful pattern. These shoes by, and I'm going to butcher this person's name, but it's Sebastian Ratzitz, are really a beautiful way of showing the fragility, but structure, because this honeycomb structure is incredibly strong. This modular shelving was shown at the Milan Furniture Fair, one of design's most illustrious events in the past two, I think it was last year, by Clive Wilkinson. And this is a fragmented hexagon that's actually made out of wood. And it's so that this is actually a wooden textile that moves by Eliza Strotzik. What's also interesting about the hexagon is the fact it's modular. You can start putting things together. So this is a lampshade by the group Design Tree. And it doesn't come as a lampshade, it comes as pieces. So these pieces, you get them in the mail, and you can put them together. There's a myriad of options. So you can see here some of the different forms that it can take. And of course, let's not forget the tiles. Anyone who's had a bathroom from the 1950s has hexagon tiles in it. It's there. I just put hexagon tiles in my bathroom last year. This is a really beautiful, and unfortunately the detail didn't quite come out on that, but basically the hexagon tiles was actually inlaid into an old wooden floor, and this is done by the designer Paola Novone. So this was a really obvious example, and it's beautiful. They're very beautiful, but I think we can go a little bit deeper with honeybees. I'd like to start out with an example from the website asknature.org. This is a search engine that Biomimicry Institute has put together in order to give everyone access to nature's genius. So basically, you can go to this website and ask, how does nature, and in this case was land gently, and unfortunately the pop-up came up, but basically it's about how honeybees land. So I wanted to take something a little bit less obvious. So this here is the Arctic bumblebee. He's adorable. Look at how fuzzy he is. I want to give him a hug, but I know he'll sting me, so I won't. No hugging the bumblebees. He looks stereotypical, but they live in either Arctic or Alpine regions, and they have to fend off the cold that exists in that environment. And while they have that wonderfully adorable insulating coat of hair, it's not enough for the Arctic winters. In order to fly, these bees require a body temperature of 35 degrees Celsius, much similar to our own body temperature. But this bee is able to use its ability to shiver to keep itself warm. It can raise its body temperature up to 15 degrees Celsius above the air temperature in order to keep flying in significantly colder conditions than other insects, which gives them an incredible advantage as they can keep their colony growing while all the other insects go into a deep torpor. So you may ask, how can we use this for design? That seems like something Jim would tell you. And so I'll tell it to you, but Jim would probably know more, and I'm looking forward to hearing more from him on what more about this Arctic bumblebee. But how can we use this for design? Ask Nature has a suggestion of using the wind hitting the side of a skyscraper to generate heating. Well, interesting, I wanted to go more extreme. And of course, within my own field, and as you all heard, I come from a fashion background. What happens if we could create a shivering winter jacket? And this jacket that could keep us warm through those cold Canadian winters that the rest of the country sees. We're lucky not to have them, but you know, I'm thinking about the other people. So as a designer, I of course had to test it out. So I'm just gonna grab something. So we're gonna test this out here. So this here is my old winter jacket. I used to live in Montreal, so therefore I needed an actual winter jacket. What I've done in it, maybe I'll show you guys this, is I've actually put in here a little motor, and it's a vibrating motor, and just attached it with conductive thread, and I'm gonna put a battery in, and it actually vibrates. And so I'm gonna get that close to the microphone, if it's still working. Yeah, there we go. Can you guys all hear? So if that function really does create warmth, I actually have no idea. But you know what? It really inspired me to look at how we create warmth in a different way. Normally, as a designer and a designer of clothing, jackets, things like that, I think insulation. I got to keep this insulated. I think polar bears. I think all these things that have we are trying to keep the hot air in. But what happens if we could create our own hot air? So I also like to think it would be really, really interesting is if you were walking around on a cold winter's night and somewhere probably colder than here, and I can imagine there's like crunching snow under your boots, and you hear this faint buzz from everyone around you, and it would all just sound a little bit more like bees. And I think that would be a really interesting, yeah, exactly. Everybody just a little bit of buzzing. So now, of course, this is only one example, and there's a plethora of more examples on AskNature.org from bees on how they use, some of them on how they use polarized light to navigate and can sense electromagnetic charges before a storm to safely return to their hive. These and so many more from the entire natural world are at the heart of understanding the power of nature and how it can be applied to human invention and innovation. I hope you guys have a chance to check out their website and see how you too can be inspired by bees or any other organism in your next project. So as we've heard the sound of an alarm, bees are in danger. We've all heard it. It was on the front page of the Metro newspaper last week. I'd like to suggest that design has a role to play in the attempt to create a place for bees in our urban environment. The city of Paris certainly believes so. As you walk along the streets, there's often a hive or two in every little tiny park. Or many, as in the case of the Luxembourg Gardens. While this charmingly rustic aesthetic works well in Paris, I don't think it really suits Vancouver. Could a redesign of the hive itself bring more acceptance to keeping bees amongst us? Timothy Rifle of Hive and Coop of Cleveland looks to create hives that are of an ornamental nature as to increase the acceptance of the bees within cities and suburban areas. The electronic company Phillips believes the same, which they illustrated with this conceptual appliance for the future, where bees are welcome on even the most foreboding of surfaces, the glass tower. And we have many of those here. So I when I looked at this, I was like, oh yeah, we could just be a city of bees. Design can certainly play a role in creating this environment where we feel comfortable with bees, where they're part of our everyday. And I hope that in the future, we have more of that in our lives. I also wanted to share with you all a little bit about the nature of inspiration and how bees have allowed me to see inspiration from a completely different perspective. Inspiration is tricky. I'm sure there's probably lots of people in the audience who have some sort of creative outlet in their lives. And it's tricky. One moment it's there, the next it slips away, and a great deal of the time you're waiting for that aha moment. You just kind of sit there and you wait for it. And it usually comes very late and after a great many false starts and a myriad of problems. We often look to the nature of inspiration as a bit of magic. It just happens after excessive amounts of what seems like wandering toil. But I think we can take a lesson on how to be inspired by the work of the bumblebee. Now, the hard work of a bee is legendary and is tipped over into cliché, as being busy as a bee is understood quite easily throughout our culture. But I don't think it's just the hard work to take inspiration from, but it's how they go about their work that is so interesting, and I believe directly relates to inspiration. Upon a normal day, a bumblebee visits 50 to 100 different flowers in a single collection flight. With all the time in the world, I spent this past summer just watching them. I watch them by the side of the road, in my garden, often fending off mosquitoes on alpine trails, just trying to figure out what is it that they do. What I noticed in my designerly attempt to understand them, because I don't have that deep scientific knowledge, is I saw their behavior in a different way than I was expecting. Upon lighting onto a flower, a bee collects the nectar and moves on to the next. And it dawned on me is that this is what it takes to find inspiration. We must keep moving. We must stop ever so briefly, learn something new, leave that place knowing just a little bit more with the goal of lighting upon the next flower or topic, and then again moving on. To look at the world with a curious thirst for all that it has to offer, it is after all that work that inspiration will find us. It is the culmination of the wanderings of curious mind, looking to understand various topics and outlooks on the world that create something new. Much like a pound of honey can only be created after 2 million flowers have been visited by the hive, so does inspiration arrive when you cross-pollinate the things you know with topics outside your comfort zone and create new ideas and perspectives. And I'm going to pass it onward now to Levente. Thank you.
Stephanie, that quote idea is genius. Can you put me down for?
Yeah, sure. I'll get you one.
Like Stephanie, I'm also interested in design, but I'm interested in the design of brains. And Jim told you about honeybees and bumblebees. I know very little about honeybees, but I'm going to be talking to you more about bumblebees. Now, today someone called me a bumblebee psychologist, so I'm embracing this new label. But I have to reassure you, I'm not using a Freudian approach, and I don't do bee therapy, and I can't ask them about why their populations are declining. Despite my shortfalls, I can ask many questions with bees, using bees, about questions that are psychological in nature. So if you stick with me, I'm going to tell you about three reasons that I think we should use bees in psychology, and I am, so check off, Mark. And in the second part, I'd like to show you how we do some of these studies in the bee lab at Kwantlen. So let me start off with this beautiful sports car. It's a high-end sports car, and it's got a lot of bells and whistles, a lot of features that our Honda Civics or whatnot probably don't have. For example, did you know this Ferrari has an engine with a twin turbo? It has not one or none, but two turbos, right? Now imagine if you were aspiring to become a car mechanic, you would not want to start off with the most complicated car that exists out there, right? You would probably start off with a simpler car, probably maybe even a lawnmower engine to understand how it works, right? So imagine that the human brain is the Ferrari engine in the animal kingdom. It's the most complicated brain that there is out there. Now also imagine that psychologists are trying to figure out with a wrench, really. That's all we got to figure out how the human brain works. And of course, the metaphorical wrench here is fMRI machines, or EEG machines, which produce beautiful snapshots of the brain. And we are very proud and very impressed with the kinds of information that they can produce. But they're far from perfect. Brain imaging tools are limited. As if we want to keep, you know, the human alive in the process, and we don't want to slice up the brains, they're quite limited. We can't peek in with high resolution. So let me give you an example. So imagine here is a map of our surrounding area, and let's say I ask you to navigate to Science World tonight, and you can immediately see hotspots where there's a lot of congestion, there are accidents, there are construction zones, etc., etc. But it would take you just a minute to trace your optimal route to Science World, right? In fact, you can just ask Google and it'll do it for you. Now, if I were to take an image of this area using an fMRI machine, it would look something like this. And I know you can't take pictures of cities with an fMRI machine, but play along with me here. Let's say you could. If you did, you would get an image of resolution quality that is like this. And I'm being generous. So you would see, I mean, you can see the streets are merging together. You can see that there are red blobs and yellow blobs. And you can see that there is a hot spot of activity in the downtown region and fairly quiet around there. But you can't really, if I asked you to navigate yourself to Science World, you couldn't, because it's not very clear what's what and where's where. And this is the kind of image fMRIs or EEGs can produce for us today. We can't really know what is happening in the brain. We're getting an idea of it. But we are in luck. And we're in luck because brains didn't start with humans. It turns out there are brains before us. And there are brains that, did you know, chimps and apes have brains, goldfish, frogs, lizards, snakes. They all have brains, and including insects. Their insects have brains. And brains are, of course, a product of hundreds of millions of years of evolution, of brain development. And you can think about brains as being incrementally bigger and incrementally bigger over these period of years. So sure, we are very proud humans because we are able to count very much, except when it comes to mortgage rates. And we have language fine-tuned pretty well. We do it quite well compared to other animals. And we can even contemplate about our own existence, which is, indeed, these are uniquely human abilities. But that's not the only question we want to know about the brain or about psychological questions. There are questions in social cognition, for example, how do we learn from one another? Or how do we learn at all from the environment, from elsewhere? How do we form memories? That's a huge area of research, and there are important questions to be answered there. Emotion and perception, how do we make sense of the visual world? That's also a very big question. And guess what? They're not uniquely human abilities. Most other animals can have those kinds of abilities. Which brings me to my second reason that we should use bees in psychology, and that's that bees have very capable brains. For example, I'll give you a couple of examples. Bees can learn. They have ability to learn symbolic language. We can teach bees that different kinds of shapes and different kinds of forms can be associated with, for example, turning left in a maze or turning right in a maze. And so, just like signposts, we can actually send bees down in a maze successfully and we can get them through the maze. That's pretty sophisticated learning, if you ask me. They're also capable of memorizing things, and it's amazing what they can. In fact, the experiments are becoming boring because whatever we try to get them to memorize, they memorize everything. They can memorize smells, colors, shapes, markings on a flower. They can see into all kinds of different colors that even we can't see. So they have excellent memory capabilities, not unlike humans. And I'm particularly interested in the visual world of the bees because there are a lot of perceptual questions that we can ask. And bee vision or bee color vision is not very dissimilar from humans. They're also what's called trichromats, which means that they can see color similarly to us, which is not even true, for example, for cats, mice, or even dogs, which either are completely monochromats, which means they see in black and white, or they can see some faded version of colors. Bees can see into the UV range a little bit more so than humans, so they can see special markings on flowers that are designed for them. But they can see red colors, for example, as well as humans do. Of course, their visual spatial frequency ability is a little bit worse, so they have to be very close to flowers in order to see them clearly. So their acuity is suffering a little bit. But most importantly, relating to this reason, bee brains deal with the same physical energy as humans do. The light, in the case of the visual world, is the same. Physically, it's the same physics that is acting on both of us. And secondly, the evolutionary pressures that are acting on the bee to survive are the same as for us. We also want to survive. So these are two concrete elements that are identical for all. In fact, it's for all animals, not just bees. I'm singling out bees here. And so I'll give you a third reason to use bees in psychology, and that's that they're fairly affordable and practical, at least to start out. You can get to pretty sophisticated and expensive experiments, but it's not too bad to start out. And let me show you a picture. So you can start out with a classroom. So this is what was at Kwantlen in 2014 when we started out building a bee lab. And you can start with a small classroom and build a flight cage inside, a flight cage that is has a steel frame in this case, and it's really just mosquito netting, but get the aluminum reinforced one. And at the end, we just attached the bumblebee colony boxes on the outside of the flight cage, like so. And in order to observe them, we can use cameras. You can see them on top. And we can record their behavior. We can, I'll show you in a second in exactly how that looks. In terms of how we observe them, of course, if we want really affordable methods to record them, we can take a pencil and a notebook, and we can just look at where the bees are landing, what they're doing on the flower, and so on and so forth. So that it doesn't get any cheaper than that, right? But if we have a little bit of funding, then we can, of course, get a couple of cameras or maybe use radio frequency identification tags or RFIDs. You know, the swipe cards work with that technology. They're miniaturized for bees, so you can use that to track each and every bee in a colony, for example. And of course, if there's more funding available, then we can use a microscopy to look at directly brain activity using confocal microscopes or other fancy imaging techniques. And in robotics, too, there are a lot of interesting questions about recreating a miniaturized flying autonomous drone, of course, to spy on us. So, how do we use bees in the bee lab? Well, you need, here's the recipe. You need three things for it. The first thing that you need are flowers, real or fake. I prefer the fake variety because they're easier to make, and I can just use a laser printer to create various kinds of shapes, whether it's different colors or different markings or different random blobs. The second thing you need are bees. And you can release the bees in the flight. We put them in a flight cage just because it gets a little bit unwieldy if you release them inside the classroom or the campus. And finally, we need to record what the bees are doing. So we simply use either on any of these automated or manual techniques, and we count how many times bees land on different kinds of flowers. And from that, we can decide, we kind of infer that bees prefer different colors and different shapes and so on and so forth. Here are some pictures of, so here's a bumblebee hive. You can see that there's a glue, an RFID tag. So here's another close-up of the chip that we glue to the back of the bee. Once bees have this, and I've once tagged a whole colony of bees, and that was a large one, 200-300 individuals, then we can individually track each bee's behavior, and we exactly know when they've left, when they've come back, where they've landed, what they've done, and so on and so forth. Here's another shot of the why is it so dark? So this is the bumblebee box right here. There's a tunnel. The button on this. Oh, here. There. So there's a tunnel right there, which leads them into this flight cage over here. And you can see that there are two readers, artificial flowers with the readers in them. Here's another shot of that. So you can see that that's how they look like. And here's another angle. You can see that the radio antenna reader is over there. So as soon as the bee walks in the vicinity of that reader, we can detect what they're doing and that they've been there. And here's the other technology, that this is what we have currently in the bee lab. These are very simple plastic number tags. It's very simple, but with the right tools, for example, telephoto lenses on cameras, we can zoom in directly on the flower, we can read off the tag. And so we can, just like with the RFID chips, we can track a whole colony of bees using this technique. The only limitation here is that the number tags are only two digits long. So at 99, we have to use a different color or something like that. So here's a short video clip of what we can record. So here we've got actually a social landing, two bees on one artificial flower, and they seem to be liking each other a lot. they're both workers. So. And here's another shot. You've got so the cameras. Here are the nest boxes, and released into this flight space. And so that's where the two patterns are displayed. And so I can tell you just a couple of results that we are getting using these kinds of experiments. We know, for example, that bees prefer radiating flowers over bullseye kind of patterns. They really hate that one. It's interesting, there's another finding that they prefer central markings. Anything that's at the center of a disc seems to be more preferred for them than if it was on the periphery. So if I present this and this, they're going to prefer this one. But if I present to them this versus this, then I'm presenting them with a conflict. and most, depending on the kinds of setup I have, they sometimes prefer this one, sometimes this one. So we can actually pull apart and pit against each other different kinds of visual properties that the bees we know prefer and not prefer. And here in this line, you've got just random blobs. Here's the true random blob. That's a true random blob too. And the only thing that we've done is make them symmetrical. And if you introduce a little bit of symmetry, bees love that. And the more you increase the symmetry, we could increase the symmetry on every axis that you can imagine, the bees will be drawn to it more and more. So these are kind of the building elements to a flower, basically. If you think about a flower, there's nothing common in them. They're different colors, they're different smells, they're different sizes. But what is it that still brings these bees out to land on them? And with bumblebees, they don't dance to each other. How do they know when they come out for the first time what a flower even looks like? And so these give us some clues about what the building elements of a flower are and what is establishing the space for that initial contact. So these are the two most favored. What I didn't mention here was that there's another element here about complexity. Bees prefer less complex patterns over more complex patterns. So the take-home message for you today is that I think, and I hope you do now too, bees are a useful model to study research questions that are psychological in nature. And it's because bees have very capable brains. They can learn, they can memorize, and they have a whole host of other cognitive features. And they're very practical. Thank you.
Hi, everybody. It's a real honor to be here today to get to present a little bit about some of the work that I've been doing with the Environmental Youth Alliance. Let's just see if I can get our slides up here. So it is really an honor to be on the unceded territories of the Squamish, Musqueam, and Tsleil-Waututh people. I wanted to acknowledge that we are on their unceded territories today. And it's been for me, one of the highlights of my life to get to work on this Wild Mind project. It's something that we started just in really the last year. And we started out in the Strathcona Community Garden with a space that was really impacted by human development. So it was a space that used to be a tidal marsh that had been filled in by humans. And there was really just one species of invasive Himalayan blackberry growing on this property. And we decided that we wanted to work with the Parks Board to clear the land and to try to establish a wildlife area, kind of a rewilding project, and to work with local youth in trying to understand how we could invite bees and other kinds of local animals back into the inner city urban core of East Vancouver. So in this very kind of industrialized neighborhood, we were able to clear all of that blackberry, and to start planting a real diversity of different kinds of native shrubs, all kinds of different things that flowered at different times to attract lots of different local pollinators. And it was really an experiment also in just trying to understand how we could work with urban youth to try to reconnect them back to a sense of nature and wilderness. We wanted to try to understand a little bit more about what wild actually means for a sort of inner city urban youth, like what is wild. And so while we were planting all of these native plants and trying to keep them alive, we've been asking a lot of questions about what wildness means to youth and what it means in the context of a sort of a city like Vancouver that's really trying to become this very green sort of leading city in the world. And we've done lots of really fun stuff in this space. This is a picture of a group of youth who were making salmon puppets to go to the wild salmon caravan. We've done lots of different kinds of creative youth engaged programming in our wildlife area, really just to try to explore these questions with youth and uncover what it really means to be helping bees and other kinds of animals. And you can see here, this is, you know, from when we cleared the land in March to about when this picture was taken in July, the landscape has really changed and transformed in a very short period of time. We went from kind of a landscape dominated by blackberry. This is where the city had kind of flail mowed and cut down all of the blackberry. They came in with machines and actually dug up the blackberry, and we continued and continue to pull blackberry from the site. They cleared it for us. This is a picture taken in early March. We planted a whole bunch of things. A lot of things came in and started to grow on the site, and we've been pulling weeds kind of here and there to try to keep the native plants and things that we've planted alive, but also watching and seeing what comes and starts to grow in the space. We've done a lot of different kinds of experiments, planting different areas with different kinds of pollinator mixes and different kinds of native shrubs, and we've been out watching a lot with youth and trying to understand which plants the bees like, which plants the birds like, and we've been learning a lot in the short period of time that we've been doing this work about what kinds of plants work well in these very urbanized sort of locations, and we're continuing to learn, of course, as we go. Something that we're doing that I'd like to invite you guys all out to is a theater performance with local youth, where we're inviting youth to this space to be inspired by the rewilding work that we're doing, and to invite youth to participate in creating a live theater performance as part of our Wild Minds project, and that's going to be performed on September 24th at the Strathcona Community Garden. So it's another way of just exploring this question of what does wild mean, and giving youth an opportunity to share their perspective with a diverse kind of group of people in Vancouver. So the Wild Mind Project is really, I would say, oriented and based in this rewilding area in the Strathcona Community Garden. But the Wild Mind Project also has a sort of a second piece to it, and that's a school program that we've been designing. So our Wild Mind School Project is a project that works with secondary science teachers to engage high school-aged youth in really just going outside, planting some things in their schoolyard or in an area close to their school, and trying to create a natural space on their school ground that's a bit of a refuge for high school students. There's a lot of really good science that shows if young people have access to nature, they'll go there when they're feeling stressed as a way of de-stressing. There's lots of good science that shows that being out in natural environments is good for us. It actually reduces our blood pressure, and it helps us in a lot of different ways to de-stress and to unwind. And so we're trying to create spaces for youth to do that in the first visit of this project. And then we're giving youth opportunities through the year to go outside and really to experience what they're learning in their science classes, to participate in this kind of slow pedagogy approach where they get to sit and watch and see what kinds of birds, what kinds of bees, what kinds of people even are using the space around their school, and try to connect some of the content that they're learning in their classroom to the real world and the neighborhoods around which they live. So I'm really just honored to be here and to be able to share a little bit of the work of the Environmental Youth Alliance We're an organization that's been working in the city for 25 years. We have a real strong mandate of trying to connect urban youth to the natural world. If you're interested in learning more about our work, the Wild Mind Project is just one of many programs that we do. We do a lot of really great work with pollinators. I'd love to chat with you more about our work at the Environmental Youth Alliance, and you can also check us out on the interwebs. It's www.eya.ca, and be in touch. We've got lots of volunteer opportunities too for people of all ages if you're interested in getting involved in some sort of urban garden project. We have 5 big gardens that we maintain, and we'd love to see you out at one of those spaces. Thanks for the opportunity.
Falling down. Wonderful, wonderful talk. So, time for a few questions. And I don't know if we have some roaming microphones. We've got one over there and one over here. So I'll call our group back up here. And we can probably just yell. Yep. So I will, any questions? And we have one right in the front here. And
this is actually back in this beginning of the talk. Talking about the queen bumblebee. Now, we talked about how they create the female workers, the males that end up disrupting everyone, as is common to males. But how does the next generation of queen bumblebee come into being?
Okay, the question was, within the queens, how do they detect the change or the males being present disrupts the hive? How is the continuity there for the queens to come back for the next generation?
Yeah, pretty much exactly. How does a new queen come in?
Okay, so what will happen with the bumblebees is that when the males start being produced, the females that are in there, instead of becoming workers, they become veritable queens. They go out of the hive, mate, and come back. They will be allowed to feed, get nourishment, and then they're kicked out for the winter. So that point in the hive is called crossover. So that's when the bees sense that either the queen dies or that there are males developing, and they're no longer going to become workers, they're going to become queens. And they start to feed themselves more and become bigger as well. It's a really nifty system of intrinsically balanced biology. Amazing.
Back there.
Hi, Jim. I have a question for you as well. As homeowners, what can we do to help the bees out?
The question was about homeowners, what you can do to help bees out. Mark Winston wrote an article. It was commissioned by Van City to summarize the issue of the importance of bees and what their peril is and what we can do. If you Google Van City, Mark Winston, and bees, you'll find it. I think basically he said that the most important things that are affecting bees, all bees, not just bumblebees, but honeybees, is first of all, excess use of pesticides. So as a homeowner, the city of Vancouver means you cannot use certain pesticides, but the city cannot mandate whether you can buy them. They can say, no, you can't use it, but you can still buy it. So there's a disconnect there. And if we decrease the amount of pesticides, that's the first thing. The second thing is nutritional. The habitat for bees is becoming really difficult for them to survive. That's why Matthew's project with Environmental Youth Alliance is so important, because it helps us to connect the dots and make corridors in the urban environment that help bees get around and help provide the nutrition that they need. As a homeowner, don't mow your lawn in spring. Oh, I heard a cackle. Good. Yeah, you're on board? Good. That's because the dandelions are one of the first flowers that the bees utilize as a source of pollen and nectar. So don't cut your grass in the early springtime. Don't use pesticides. The other thing that Mark Winston said that I think indirectly we can work towards that is affecting the lifestyle and survival of the bees is climate change. That we can all work on, but we have to put pressure on the legislatures to do something about it. And they must take more action fast. Does that help?
With a fellow in the middle there with a beard.
Thank you very much. I had a question similarly related anyways, and if we as, like, everybody on the planet can't do enough to help with the decline of the bee population, how challenging would it be for humans to implement like a man-made method of pollinization? Because you had mentioned that most of the food that we consume is grown through pollinization. So is there a way that humans can kind of step in and help with that?
I'm sure Jim would know a little bit more about this, but the complexity of that type of basically the drones that Levente showed us would be incredibly difficult, and I don't know if we would ever get to the same efficacy as the bees do right now. We may start having grocery stores with less food. That could change how we feed ourselves in terms of whether it is then we start eating algae and some of the other things that don't necessarily need, or insects, yes, of course, insects. So it would actually just change our diet completely.
There was a place in China where bees were completely wiped out, and it was a big orchard-producing region, and so they actually started paying people to do the pollination for the bees. And if you search this on Google, you'll find all these wild pictures of people up in trees with paintbrushes pollinating the orchards. And they actually found that they got more fruit production because the people were very meticulous and the bees kind of moved around a lot and weren't actually quite as meticulous. But the cost of paying people to do all of that work has become really too much in that region, and people are starting to demand fairer wages. And where it was once a place where they could pay people very, very, very little to do that work, it's becoming a place where you can't do that anymore. And they've had to start shipping in bees from other parts of the world and changing their agricultural practice so that the bees can survive there.
Levente, you want to add anything?
I guess I can add a little bit about the robo-bees. We can already get bees to fly around miniaturized. It would not take too much. Now it's the software part. How do you get a robot to fly around and identify flowers? That's probably the hardest part right now, to write the brain of the bee. And I'd say within the next 5 to 10 years, we'll have pretty interesting prototypes. But it will be a lot more expensive than the few cents we pay for each worker. So.
There was another question here and over there. Yeah.
Hi there. You did mention about the one which was on the Metro News that was about the zombie bees.
Yes.
Do you think it's a big problem for BC, or is there any chance to eliminate that?
The question was relating to zombie bees. This is a situation where there's a parasite of bees, a small fruit fly that develops inside the bees, and they become less active, and they look like zombies that just walk around and don't do anything. No pollination, no nothing. Is it an important problem? Are we concerned with it? Heck yes. Okay, absolutely. The number of times we brought in pests with imported plants or other insects that have caused a crash, Agriculture Canada tries to maintain as close an eye as they do on things. But still, people bring things across the border. take a plant back, brought some seeds with you, some ladybird beetles from the States. The number of times we've done stupid things. And this is a case where, yes, it could cause quite a problem. That similar situation was with spotted winged Drosophila fruit fly, closely related, that's causing a crash in the raspberry industry in BC and can infect cherries and blueberries, okay? So yeah, we should be scared of it.
There's a question over on that side, way on the back.
I've got the microphone. Is this loud enough? I don't hold microphones often. My question's for Levente?
Yes.
And it might sound silly. I'm curious to know how you put the ID tags on the bumblebees. What kind of
glue do you use? Yes, we don't use Gorilla Glue. But there's something called a bee glue. What else would it be called, of course? It's a toxin-free glue that is, in terms of its behavior, its substance, it feels the same as any glue. And we put a little dab of it on the thorax of the bee, and we put the tag on it. But we have to wait for a good 5 to 10 minutes because bees are bugged out by it and they try to scratch it off. And so we have to wait until the glue actually hardens. If you'd like to see it, if you log on to the Kwantlen website, kpu.ca/bee lab, you can actually see a video clip of how we do this.
Mm-hmm. We'll take one more question, and then I'm sure all of our speakers would love to talk to you afterwards. We have over there.
Hi. I've read a little bit that you guys are kind of alluding to it, that, you know, most of our food, or one third of our food or something like that, is coming from pollinators. And yet, I think the discussion I hear a lot of the time, even here, is about having bees in urban areas. And that's not really where the problem is. It seems like the problem is decline in bee populations in areas where we grow food, where we are using pesticides, and where there's very little discussion going on, at least not that I'm getting. You know, it's not filtering back to the average person. So I'm just wondering if somebody could speak to that.
Yeah. I think you're right that it's a concern everywhere, and one thing that we do at the Environmental Youth Alliance is try to educate people in the city about what's happening in the natural world so that we can make more informed decisions. More than 50% of our population now in Canada lives in cities, and so they're accessing food that's grown in the country. And a lot of the decisions we make in the grocery store about what to buy impact the bees, right? If we're purchasing things based specifically just on price point and always getting the cheapest product, it may not be the most environmentally sensitive product. That being said, it's very challenging for a lot of people to do anything but purchase the cheapest thing in the grocery store, and there's a lot of social and political issues associated with why that is. And so addressing things in the city doesn't mean that we're not also addressing things in the countryside. I think it's important to recognize that when we're eating something, we are connected to the countryside. We're connected to where that food is growing. So we all have to eat. And when we're trying to teach people here in the city about bees and the peril of bees, the peril that's facing the bee populations is one that's not urban specific or country specific or Canada specific. It's happening all over the world. And it's an issue everywhere. So. There are lots of challenging complexities to the reasons why it's such a big issue. But there's lots that we can do here in the city to try to address it, I guess, I would say.
I have another thing to say to put in the plug. There's also, Mark Winston pointed out that one of the things we can do is get more beekeepers in the population. I believe Kwantlen now has a certificate in the hallway, and talking about becoming a professional beekeeper. One of the issues with bee survival in the country, those bees are shipped from crop to crop, and the nutrition is really limited. That's hard on them. But with more beekeepers in the city, the hives move around. In BC, we have one of the best success rates for hive survival and think it's going to be even better with more beekeepers in the program.
Great, thank you. See, I'm doing this right. Well, we have to make a few thank yous here. So besides our wonderful speakers, we have to thank the Office of Research and Scholarship, Science World, Faculty of Arts, Faculty of Science and Horticulture, the Office of the Provost for continuing with these talks. And I'd like to invite you to our next talk in September, and I'd like you to invite you out to KPU Richmond. So Canada Line takes you right out there. It get off on the Lansdowne stop, and you're right there, about a half a block to walk. Dr. Ross Pink will be talking about another very not terribly unrelated topic, and that is our water. What another thing that's very important to us. So water rights, scarcity, and he'll be looking at some political views of that because he's one of our instructors in our political science department. So again, thank you to, where's our Stephanie, ladies first. There you go, Stephanie. Matthew, and Jim. And please do come and talk to our speakers afterwards. And enjoy your evening and go, you know, maybe get yourself a hive and put it on your deck. Thank you again.